I now call the October 17th, 2017 regular council meeting to order. Would council members please denote your presence by depressing your yes switch? Miss a couple meetings and you're out of practice. Whew.
All council members are present.
Council meetings are also televised and can be viewed on cable channel 192. I don't see any victims in the audience to torture, so please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. The chair would entertain a motion to approve by minute action the minutes of the October 3rd, 2017 regular council meeting as published in the Casper Star Tribune on October 11th, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Councilman Morgan, seconded by Councilman Hopkins. Any corrections? Please cast your vote. And please record the vote.
All members voting aye. Motion passes.
The chair would entertain a motion to approve by minute action the October 17th, 2017 bills and claims as audited by City Manager Napier.
So moved.
Moved by Councilman Johnson, seconded by Councilman Huckabee. Abstentions? Please cast your vote. And please record the vote.
All members voting aye. Motion passes.
Councilman Morgan, don't you think they switched the buttons? I'm sure that's what happened. Please read the consent agenda titles.
Establishing November 7th, 2017 as a public hearing date for consideration of the following two items: a zone change of the CPH addition generally located on Aaron Lane, west of Kaufman Avenue, from R2 one-unit residential to R3 1-4-unit residential, and the transfer of ownership interest in retail liquor license number 7, Love Holdings, LLC, doing business as C85 at the Branding Iron.
The chair would entertain a motion to, by minute action, establish the public hearing dates just read.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Vice Mayor Pacheco, seconded by Councilman Powell. Abstentions or nay votes? Councilman Huckabee.
Abstention from me.
Okay. Anyone else? Please cast your vote. And you're a yes on the other one, Councilman Huckabee?
The abstention made by Councilmember Huckabee noted. Motion passes.
Please read the consent ordinance on third reading by title only.
An ordinance amending Chapter 17.68 of the Casper Municipal Code pertaining to gaming gambling in the C2 General Business Zoning District.
The chair would entertain a motion to approve on third reading the consent ordinance just read.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Councilman Hopkins, seconded by Councilman Johnson. Please cast your vote. And please record the vote.
All members voting aye. Motion passes.
Council will now discuss the ordinance pertaining to resort liquor licenses. Because this is not on the consent agenda, it will be open for discussion by council. Please read the ordinance on second reading by title only.
An ordinance amending Chapter 5 of the Casper Municipal Code pertaining to resort liquor licenses.
The chair would entertain a motion to approve on second reading the ordinance just read.
So moved. Second.
Moved by Councilman Johnson, seconded by Councilman Morgan. Council will now listen to a citizen that signed up to speak on this topic. Public comments are limited to 5 minutes and no duplication of speakers will be allowed. Mr. Lamberson, come on down. Good evening.
Good evening. Thank you, Mayor, Council. I'm Bruce Lamberson. I live at 2449 Hogadon Road, and I've lived up, that's adjacent to Hogadon. I've been up there since 1973, and over that time I've been involved with outdoor recreation up there, specifically with Hogadon, and I, for most of those years, have operated the rental ski and snowboard facility at Hogadon. Last few years, I've been involved with the design and planning and all the things going on into the creation of the new lodge, and then the Friends of Hogadon, which is the 501c3, raising money for enhancements up there. pertaining to the amendment of the Casper Municipal Code, obviously that's one step, but I think we all recognize the step is moving towards the issuing of a resort license to Hogedon, because it's the only ski area around, and that's what this pertains to. Over the last 6 months, I've spent a fair amount of time visiting with Tom Montoya, the compliance manager, and Kelly Hunt, the compliance agent with the liquor division. I've tried to get a pretty good understanding of what the resort license entails. And, you know, the takeaway for me has been, first of all, that it's specifically tailored to ski areas. It's the only law down there of this sort that mentions ski areas as part of its requirements. It is assignable to a lessee who's running food and beverage services. So, you know, as you know, we've got the issuing agent, the City of Casper. In this case, if it precedes the license holder, the City of Casper, but this particular license can be moved and used by a concessionaire running food and beverage up there, which is terrific and specific to that. It's not transferable. I know Pat Sweeney had some concerns earlier in an earlier meeting. It doesn't allow off-premises sale of alcohol for off-premises consumption unless it's in a catering permit situation. So it seems really, really well tailored. Obviously, they changed the law in February to let these things happen, and now we're looking at the city ordinance complying with the state, which I think is great. There have been some concerns I'd like to address as a, you know, just because I've been up there forever. The first one is the perceived danger of the mountain road, and perception is huge here. That is a well-traveled state highway from the city limits to the top of the mountain, and then it becomes a well-traveled county highway after that. It has excellent maintenance. A lot of attention is paid to that road. Citizens commute every day up and down that road. School buses go up and down that road all the time. And for people who aren't familiar with the road, it's like, man, if you get in a problem up there, you're going to drive up, you're going off El Capitan or something. You know, you'll be done. That's not the case. It has to meet all the safety requirements of any other state highway. And as far as closures, there's a few days, I mean, I've been up there 44 years. There's a few days a year where it might be closed due to weather conditions. Far less than I-25 or I-80. I mean, those are dangerous highways in the winter. So I think accidents do happen, will happen. I think mostly when there are accidents, there are low rates of speed. You don't have head-on closing, high rates of speed, and things like this. You can go off that mountain like our Nordic coach did and a week ago Sunday with a trailer and a four-wheeler behind him. And it was just icy conditions, a real surprise condition where you're doing a trail cleanup. Things changed very rapidly, and there was one section of the road where that trailer pushed him off, he and his dad, Justin and Paul Kinner. They went off the cliff. They hit a tree. His airbags didn't even deploy because you're not going fast. So I'm just saying, it's not like 2,000 feet and you're done. I see wrecks up there. I've been in wrecks up there. Rarely are there injuries, and it's been decades since we've had any fatalities. So the perception of that being some crazy, dangerous road is simply not true. And I understand why people who don't go up there don't recognize that. But I want you to know that's my feeling, and I think any statistics would back that up. The other thing is current consumption of alcohol up there. I pick up beer cans in my yard all summer long. I know, and alcohol bottles. People drink on the mountain. Illegally, legally, whatever. The Nordic Lodge, I've hosted parties. Many people have weddings. They host those things with a liquor permit from the county to serve liquor. Bear Trap Meadow, they serve liquor. Hogedon Lodge, they serve liquor. They have for years under permitted situations. I had the pleasure of being at the first wedding up there a month ago. At that wedding at the New Lodge, which was just a fabulous event, Mike Reed with Poplar Wine and Spirits, his company and staff did an excellent job of serving alcohol, open bar, for over 4 hours to 150 people up there. And I know he's expressed some concerns, but I just want to commend the job he did. And we all had a great time, and there was plenty of alcohol served.
Mr. Lamberson, we ran out of time. Do you have a quick sentence you want to just summarize?
Yes.
Sorry.
Clearly in support of this, I do have a problem with the operational hours. I think this ordinance should be amended along with the ordinance that pertains to operation of serving of alcohol, which the city runs. I'd really like to see that close at 10 p.m. for the resort-specific license. Okay. Otherwise, they can serve till 2:30, and that creates another host of problems
right. That
I'd hope you address as soon as this matter is finished. Thanks for your time.
Thank you. Any questions from council? Okay, thank you for coming tonight.
Thank you.
Discussion amongst council. Councilman Laird and then Councilman Morgan.
That was enlightening because I used to ski up there all the time when I was young, and that was a whole different view that I had then. But the way he explained that, and I know there's several other gentlemen here that are affiliated with the Hogadon area. It's a beautiful facility. But thanks a lot, Bruce, for coming here, because I think it was at least enlightening for me, and I think the council always appreciates when they can get direct information from somebody who lives across the street from the resort and goes up there, up and down there, and your wife goes up and down there, and your kids go up and down there. I know that too. So thank you again.
Councilman Morgan.
Thank you, Mr. Lamberson, for coming here tonight. Definitely will take your comments under consideration when we get to that point. If we do decide to allow Hogadon to have a resort liquor license, the hours of operations does kind of concern me. Just my traveling days in the oil field from here to North Dakota or Texas, it's nice when you get into a hotel where you're staying the night and it might be 11 o'clock, 11:30, everything's shut down. In that whole region of North Dakota, for example, Applebee's is closed. You can't get a meal, basically, is what I'm saying, even fast food. So if you do happen to get that bar food there, and you can also have a drink, I think that's great. They're serving the people who are staying at Holiday Inn, Courtyard Marriott, Parkway, Ramcota, you know, those places that have a resort liquor license. If we do get to the point where council decides to have a resort liquor license for Hogadon, which is not what we're talking about here, but I'm addressing now, we can certainly add those restrictions if we choose. So thank you.
Councilman Powell.
Thank you, young man. Could we get your name, please?
Tyler Kessel. Oh,
thank you for stepping in. I appreciate Mr. Lamberson coming forward. But we need to stay focused on the fact that these are two separate matters. We are talking about having our ordinances line up with the new state statutes regarding resort licenses. And with all due respect, Bruce, it is not tailored to ski areas because we have five other resort licenses in the city of Casper right now. And we are talking about that simple matter of lining up our ordinances with state statute. Does it affect the option of granting a resort license to Hogadon? Yes, but the more we talk about Hogadon, the more we confuse the issue, because that discussion happens later. And so I would recommend that we not have any further discussion about Hogadon until the time comes when we will discuss that license. And we could put additional restrictions on that, including hours of operation. But that's for later. This is about simply lining up our statutes and whether or not the statute is what we want our ordinance to say, or whether there should be some different language. That's what we need to stay focused on tonight.
Okay, any further discussion?
Councilman Walsh.
Thank you, Brevet Mayor Tyler. Councilman Powell covered that very well. The last time we discussed this, we had citizen input on the catering and offsite catering. And to address that, we have existing city ordinances that restricts this license from the ability to cater. And I just want everybody to know that. And so all this does is bring it into conformance with state statute. absent the ordinance that restricts it already in existence that that will limit the catering abilities.
Okay, see, anyone else?
Anyone else?
Any amendments?
Any amendments?
Please cast your vote.
Please cast your vote. Please record the vote.
With all members voting aye, motion passes.
You want to do another one?
Sure.
Okay. So this is what I'm supposed to say, so you can just read that whole thing.
Please read the consent ordinance on the second reading by title only.
An ordinance approving a zone change for lots 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and the south 40 feet of lot 11, block 22, Nelson's Addition subdivision in the city of Casper, Wyoming. And an ordinance amending section 2.40.050 of the Casper Municipal Code pertaining to the Historic Preservation Program.
Now you read this part.
The chair would entertain a motion to approve on second reading the consent ordinance just read.
So moved.
Second.
So moved by Councilman Powell.
Moved by Councilman Powell.
Seconded by Councilwoman Huckabee.
Seconded by Councilwoman Huckabee.
Any abstentions or nay votes?
Any abstentions or nay votes?
Please cast your vote.
Please cast your vote.
And please record the vote.
And please record the vote.
With all members voting aye, motion passes.
What do you think? The next one's kind of tough. You want me to take it?
Yeah.
You want to stay up here or you want to go back down there?
I think I'll go back down there. Thank you.
Mayor, he's going to make a great governor someday.
I missed him in the audience for the pledge. So
he's going to make a great governor someday.
Absolutely. Please read the ordinance on first reading by title only.
Ordinance granting an electric utility franchise and general utility easement to Pacific Core and Oregon Corporation doing business as Rocky Mountain Power.
The chair would entertain a motion to approve on first reading the ordinance just read.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Councilman Walsh, seconded by Councilman Hopkins. Mr. City Manager, report.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, members of the council. Pursuant to requirements relating to adopting a new agreement with Rocky Mountain Power, it is appropriate that we consider this on an ordinance basis. And so, yes, this is the first reading of three that will be entertained by the council to adopt this agreement with Rocky Mountain Power. Similar to other agreements in years past, this is a 20-year term. And so council will likely not have to entertain another one of these discussions for another 20 years, potentially. Unless, of course, necessity requires amendments of some kind or type, and that has its own process as well. Nonetheless, one of the items that doesn't require an amendment for consideration, but it is an element of the ordinance you're considering, the agreement you're considering this evening, is that of the franchise fee pursuant to this new agreement with Rocky Mountain Power. We are proposing that this agreement include a franchise fee of 7%, which is an increase from 5% that is a feature of the current agreement. And so with that, the funds and so forth that would be raised pursuant to this potential increase would be included in the operations of the general fund, and pursuant to what was asked of me earlier, would indeed help to alleviate the imbalance that we see currently in the general fund from the revenue side of the discussion. Beyond that, Madam Mayor, those are the major terms that we typically get questions about as it relates to franchise fees and agreements. And so I'd certainly be open to others that council might have or other discussion that you might entertain otherwise.
Okay, thank you. Council discussion. Who was first?
Go ahead.
Okay.
I don't like the increase in the franchise fee. It does get passed on to the consumer. So when it comes to amendments, I might propose one.
concerning the franchise fee.
Vice Mayor Pacheco.
Mr. Manager, would you give us a kind of a brief about what other franchise fees around the state? Generally, are we in close to where everybody else is at, would you say? I mean, how in comparison, I guess, if you could kind of fill us in on that.
I'd be happy to. Madam Mayor, Councilman, thank you. Certainly there is a range of percentages and fees and dollars that are generated around the state. Casper is in a rather unique situation with regard to the way in which the council of past times has designed this understanding with Rocky Mountain Power and the community. In this particular circumstance here in Casper, the council has decided to designate a single percentage of the franchise to economic development. And so at this point in time, we keep careful track of that particular percentage of the franchise fee so that we can ensure that indeed it is set aside for economic development purposes. Typically, that means that we use it to pay for the city's obligation to CADA. And so from that standpoint, the city is really operating on a 4% base for this particular franchise. In my estimation, for a city of this type of capacity and influence, I would say that that is an undersized allocation to the city of Casper. With regard to then looking at it from a standpoint of it being a 6% allocation to the operations of the city of Casper, there aren't many communities that are up to the 6% level. I have to confess that, for example, a city like Cheyenne, I'm not sure what their fee would be, but I suppose it would be in the neighborhood of 5 or 6. I know there are a number of other communities throughout the state that have a 5%, and there are probably a number of other communities that are at the level of 4 and 3. But as it relates to what it is that we are asking, it's probably fair to say that there are not many other communities at a 6% level.
I didn't catch who was first on this side, sorry. Councilman Huckabee, Councilman Walsh. Councilwoman, sorry.
Inclusive language. Mr. City Manager, what are the reporting requirements from CADA back to us as far as the usage of that funding?
Madam Mayor, Councilwoman Huckabee, Council has asked from time to time to receive reports with regard to the activities of the CADA organization. There are limitations with regard to data that can be provided by CADA as it relates to their private side, if you will, of the operations. With regard to the Joint Powers Board, and that distinction gets confusing sometimes, and I recognize that, and I'll try to not confuse the matter further, but as it relates to the Joint Powers Board side of things, information is provided typically upon request by the council or the city in terms of being able to review where they put those dollars. My short answer to the question, however, as to how those dollars are used is with regard to hiring CADA as the contractor for the operations of the economic development effort here in the community that is overseen by the Joint Powers Board that is funded directly by the single percentage that I referenced earlier.
Councilman Walsh.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Did you say the whole 7% is going to CADA?
No, or 1%.
1% of the 7 is going to CADA. 6% is coming to us, and 6% is a little bit higher than standard in communities.
Councilman Powell, are you thinking? No. Okay.
Your Honor, I'm going to vote in favor of this. We have a $4 million deficit. And people have commented that we need to live within our means. Mr. City Manager, how many positions have we eliminated to date? Is we like 68? Is that the number I heard?
Madam Mayor, Councilman, it certainly is in that neighborhood. We've got more positions that we are recommending next week that we would eliminate, and so I'm hesitant to answer now, but there will be more.
The reason I ask the question is I think it's important to again state that the city has made some very serious efforts to reduce its budget that actually date back to 2012. And there are, and the obligations that the city has have not changed. And so we are not going to cut our way out of this problem. And that is the plain fact of the matter. And so when we have an opportunity to increase revenue, we're going to have to look seriously at that. We did it a few weeks ago with our fees. And that's never a fun thing, to increase fees that contractors have to pay. And they, of course, said, well, this is going to make it more difficult for us to develop the community. But I think this, and if we're going to ask the state to continue to fund the city so that we can continue our operations, I think when we have an opportunity like this to increase our revenue to a small extent, we're showing good faith that we're trying to do our part. That $4 million deficit is not going to go away. And it's real, and this is a very small effort to close that gap, which was, again, as City Manager Napier says, the primary task that we assigned him with is to look for ways to close that gap. And we'd like for it to just go away. It's not going to just go away. It's going to go away through our concerted efforts, and this is one small step we can take. Are people going to have to pay for it? Yes. That's the reality. And nobody likes to hear that we have to raise revenue, but it's irresponsible for us to act as though we can get away without doing that.
Councilman Hopkins.
Yeah, I guess I would choose not, again, for the next budget term, to use any of our reserves as we did this year. The economic downturn was very quick. Pretty much you could put it within one fiscal year, and I think we were justified in using reserves this year. But I think this is a reasonable rate, and I don't think it's out of line at all to ask people to pay the increase that would be included in our franchise fee. So.
Councilman Laird.
I need to address a question to the manager. You're going to get used to this question over time. Mr. Manager, are you recommending that we pass this?
Madam Mayor, Councilman Laird, when we look at the potential impact that it would have to a typical residential customer to include an increase of this nature, we have found, as near as we can tell, that that increase would amount to, again, for the typical residential customer, about $1.50 a month. And so when you consider that type of impact and you consider the crevasse that we've got to fill, if you will, with regard to the budget and the very limited means of raising funds in general fund operations for cities and towns in Wyoming, I have to feel obligated to recommend that this take place.
Thank you.
Councilman Morgan.
Thank you, Mayor. Just giving you, I guess, my position on this, looking at it on from a long-term perspective of 20 years, hoping that the city of Casper will continue to grow, this puts us in a good position to have that adjustment now for the future. In addition to that, We're going to be probably one of the top, I guess, percentages for the franchise fee in the state, which somewhat concerns me, especially when we're talking about economic downtime, and which has been going on since 2015. People see, spending, I guess, from the city side, and they wonder, where is it going? And I think right now we're showing citizens in this fiscal year that we're taking it seriously, we're being responsible with that. This is a way in which we can increase the general fund revenues by $900,000 plus, which is great. I think it's something that, to a certain degree, has to be done. Maybe we have to see what exactly we're getting from that 1% that's going towards CADA, and I think those discussions will be taking place prior to that third reading, and I think they should be taking place. If we're going to ask more from our citizens, I think we should ask more for what's going to change for the better in our community for economic development.
Go ahead.
Your Honor, on a completely different subject, but related to Rocky Mountain Power, I think we would be remiss to not acknowledge the achievements of Rocky Mountain Power over the past 5 years. People forget how much trouble we had with the reliability of our power system. And as I said last week when this came up and Leslie Blythe came to our meeting to talk about the agreement, the power outages that we've experienced in Casper have gone down dramatically due to the infrastructure changes that Rocky Mountain has undertaken. And I would also be remiss to say, to not note that they were, let's say, encouraged to do so by our legal department. And through a combined effort and a sense of cooperation, we now have a very reliable system with built-in redundancies. And that is an economic development matter because businesses look at those statistics when they're looking for places to move. And if the power system is unreliable, that's a problem. And so our system has changed dramatically. It's one of these things that you don't notice because your lights haven't gone off in the middle of the night. And that just hasn't been happening much in Casper because of these changes. And so Rocky Mountain Power has been a very good partner, and they deserve a lot of credit for making these changes over a short period of time.
Councilman Laird.
When the name CADA flashes up in front of me, I'm not happy.
Separate issues, though.
But because they don't tell us what they do with our money, and you've heard me say that. And so, but I'm not going to let that affect my vote on this. But we're paying them $400,000 a year, and they won't account for the money. And nobody seems to care. So I want to quit paying them that $400,000. And I'd like to do it starting in the morning. But I just want you to know how I feel about that. If we're giving people taxpayer money, they have to be held accountable, and they have to tell us where they spend every penny of that money. I really feel serious about that, Mr. Manager. And so when the word CADA came out, it puts my antenna up, and I'm just not happy with their accounting to us. Thank you.
Further discussion. And was somebody going to propose an amendment?
Your Honor.
Okay.
I would like to see the franchise fee stay at 5% and reevaluate how CADA is funded by the city.
So Councilman Johnson's motion on the floor is to change from 7% to 5% with a side note to reevaluate CADA. So does he have a second on his motion?
Point of order. Can I vote half for doing that part with CADA?
We will have that discussion you guys want. Don't worry.
I'll second it.
Okay. So then I believe we're opened up for discussion. Councilman Walsh.
I agree with Dallas, and but they're separate issues, and I'm afraid we will put this on the back burner again with CADA because I feel the same way. So when the amendment would be basically a reduction of 5%. The rest of it would be up for us to take the initiative and actually follow through with it. I don't know that we've done a good job on that in the past and actually had a sincere conversation about it. I'm with Dallas. Cut off their funding tomorrow. But basically, the amendment, really the weight of the amendment is 5% franchise fee, and we'll have to do some back-end work.
A point of order, Mayor. Can I amend his amendment to just say that CADA shouldn't get any of this money?
No, let's save that whole discussion for a separate time.
Because if I vote for for Ms. Blythe's company, which I intend to do, I don't want it to be thought that I'm also voting that we should give 1% of this money to CADA, because I'm not doing that.
I think we made it pretty clear.
Okay.
And then we'll put that on an agenda. Okay.
I was going to suggest that we just have a work session discussion again about these very matters, yeah. But they are separate.
So further discussion on the amendment changing to 5%. Councilman Morgan.
Thank you, Mayor. Councilman Johnson, I wish you would have waited until the second reading to finish a lunch. But this, I guess, will bring forth those discussions in a work session with all of us, and I appreciate that. That's really getting to the point that I was hoping to reach by the second reading. So in that case, for more information, I'll be in favor of your motion.
Councilman Hopkins.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I think we're getting involved in local politics more than we are the good of the city. And for a buck or two a month, it's not worth the fight to move it to 5%. I think we can afford that. That's less than a cup of coffee.
Councilman Johnson.
Not everybody can afford a cup of coffee.
Okay.
Madam Mayor, can I ask Mr. Johnson a question?
No.
It's really a good one.
I'm actually going to talk. It's a miracle. I think it's important for the public to know how much we subsidize everything in this town, from Hogadon to the rec center to the water. I mean, we put in a lot of money to keep cheap rates for all of our citizens, and it's been a great thing when we can afford it, but we can't afford it anymore. And so the hard decision is that all of us citizens are going to have to start paying a little bit more to keep the city running. And I support that wholeheartedly. We tasked the city manager with a tough job, and I'm trying to be tough on my opinions of spending, and this is a solution to fix a problem. And I think we're going to have a lot more of these. So we are going to see citizens investing in Casper a little bit, and that's what probably should have happened decades ago. So with that, we are going to cast our vote on the motion to go to 5%.
Just a minute. I have a point of order. I would like to make a motion that only half of his motion, but I want to make my own motion, which is to...
We have to vote on mine still.
Well, yes.
Can we finish his and then you can...
Mr. Chairman, I can make a motion.
You can...
I want to make a motion.
Point of order. There's a motion on the floor right now, so the motion can't be made, right? Am I correct, Mr. Chairman?
Correct. We need to vote on the pending motion.
Thank you.
I wasn't trying to be rude or anything.
No, I'm good.
Okay.
I'm good.
So we'll vote, and then we'll be back to another opportunity if you want to do that.
Good.
Okay, so please cast your vote on the amendment. And please record the vote on the amendment.
Sorry, one moment. Both council members Huckabee, Morgan, and Johnson voting aye, motion to amend fails.
So we are back to the 7% change, and Councilman Laird, did you have another amendment you wanted to do?
I want to make sure that I get something on the record that everybody remembers. And I want to make a motion that CADA doesn't get one penny of this money that comes from this deal with Rocky Mountain. Now, however you want to phrase it, Mr. City Attorney, is okay with me, but I think you understand what I'm saying.
Your Honor, I don't know that we could. That's not in this franchise agreement, is it?
No, but I'll do a little bit of clarification.
We couldn't amend the, right.
I'm assuming, Mr. City Manager, we're bound by a contract. Are we locked into a contract with CADA right now?
Madam Mayor, Council, we do have an agreement with the Joint Powers Board, and the agreement basically indicates that with the county we would provide funding to help them hire a contractor to provide the economic development services to this community. There's nothing saying, however, that Council can't decide to renegotiate the agreement or stop the agreement and curtail funding. It just so happens that the means by which we provide that funding is through one of the percentages, if you will, that we collect through the Rocky Mountain Power franchise. And so if council would like additional discussion about curtailing funding to the Joint Powers Board, I would agree that that probably is a discussion that should be had separate apart from this. But indeed, if council wants to stop a percentage from being diverted to that entity, there are other things that we have to do in order to make that happen.
So, Councilman Laird, can I promise you that I will make sure we have that discussion very soon without you having to make a motion?
What did Wallace say to you?
Your Honor and members of council, my understanding is that this franchise agreement does not specifically address the distribution of money to CADA or otherwise. So a motion to amend this particular agreement actually would be misplaced, I believe.
Okay, good. I'll withdraw it then. But
you weren't going to just do it for me?
Yes, I would, but I did, because when I saw Wallace coming up, I knew he had a statement to make, and I wanted to hear what it was, because I respect his opinion as well as the acting city attorney's opinion. However, I want to make it clear that I think that I am ready to take a stand on saying no more money to CADA from any source, period. And I just don't want it to fall through the cracks, Mr. Manager.
Madam Mayor, call the question.
Okay. Please cast your vote. Is everybody clear on what they're voting for? We are voting for the 7% franchise. Okay. Please cast your vote. And please record the vote.
Council members Johnson and Huckabee voting nay. Motion passes.
Please read the consent resolutions by title only.
Item 9A1, a resolution amending the December 15th, 2014 property management contract with the Casper Housing Authority to include Building B on the Life Steps campus. Item 9A2, a resolution authorizing the fiscal year 2017-2018 contract with Casper Area Transportation Coalition, the provision of subsidized fares to low-income residents. Item 9A3, a resolution authorizing a procurement agreement with North American UV Inc. for 300 Trojan UV 3000 plus UV lamps for use at the wastewater treatment plant. Item 9A4, a resolution authorizing a contract for professional services with WLC Engineering for engineering services for the Hogadon Underground Injection Control Program Permit Project. Item 9A5, a resolution authorizing contract for professional services with ALSCO for providing professional laundry services to the Public Services Department and Support Services Department. Item 9A6, a resolution authorizing a cooperative agreement with the Wyoming Department of Transportation for I-25 litter and vegetation control. Item 9A7, a resolution authorizing an agreement with Recycled Materials LLC for phase one of the Plains Furniture Building demolition project. Item 9A8, a resolution authorizing amendment number one to the contract for professional services between the city and Thomas F. Duchin and Associates, Inc., doing business as River Oaks Communications Corporation. Item 9A9, a resolution approving contingent upon voter approval as provided in Wyoming statutes, an annual assessment of 16 mills against the assessed value of real property within the downtown development district, excluding real property used exclusively for residential purposes, and authorizing and directing the mayor to execute and the city clerk to attest thereto. Item 9A10, a resolution authorizing an agreement with Casper Legion Baseball Club, Inc. for the use of Crossroads Field 4 at the Crossroads Complex.
Thank you. The chair would entertain a motion to adopt the consent resolutions just read.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Vice Mayor Pacheco, seconded by Councilman Johnson. Abstentions or nay votes? Please cast your vote. And please record the vote.
All members voting aye. Motion passes.
Please read the consent minute action title.
Authorizing the City of Casper to participate in the National League of Cities Prescription Discount Program.
The chair would entertain a motion to approve the consent minute action agenda item just read.
So moved.
Moved by Councilman Morgan, seconded by Councilwoman Huckabee. Please cast your vote. And please record the vote.
All members voting aye. Motion passes.
And thank you, Councilman Morgan, for bringing that to us. Now's the time we invite anyone in the audience who wishes to speak with the City Council to come forward. As stated on the first page of the agenda, we ask the following. Please state your name and address. Direct all questions or comments to the mayor and only the mayor. No personal attacks on staff or council will be tolerated. Council will not respond to personnel matters. These are referred to the city manager. Questions posed by speakers may or may not be responded to. And presentations will be limited to 5 minutes, and the duplication of speakers will not be allowed, nor will time extensions be permitted. At this time, we'd ask anybody who wishes to speak to council to come on down. Well, hello, young man.
Hello, my name is Tyler Kessel, 726th Street, Mills, Wyoming, 82644. Good evening. In April, I was nominated for the Junior National Young Leaders Conference held in Washington, D.C. by my science teacher, Mr. Brant Young. And I had written to Madam Mayor for a donation, but due to budgets, I was not able to get one, but I was invited to speak to the members of the council and Madam Mayor. I really had fun learning with students from all 50 states, including the District of Columbia. So one leadership that I felt that I did not have well developed yet was my teamwork. And Junior National Young Leaders Conference really did help me with that. We did many different simulations, and one of them did help with my teamwork, and it was Peace Patch Protest is what it's called. I didn't actually protest, thankfully, but it was more of a debate than anything. So I have a description of it, and this is all make-believe. So there was these students in a town. There were students in a town. I don't know what town. They didn't give a description on that. These kids did not feel safe because of the fact that there were not enough police officers in this town. So these students started wearing these peace patches over their mouths. These patches had peace signs on them. The principal, along with the teachers, did not agree with this idea of the patches over the students' mouths. The students set up a debate in order to help out with trying to be able to protest that there were not enough police officers in this town. In a debate, you use a lot of leadership skills, including mostly teamwork, because you have to work with others, and there's a lot of flexibility that comes in it, too. So I learned to have flexibility and teamwork in this. Another activity we did is the Voices of Change project. We had to create an organization that would help encourage diversity or prevent cyberbullying. In my leadership focus group, we decided to help with diversity. Our organization name was Washington Diverse City, or Washington DC. We thought that the name fit perfectly. Our little jingle was sang in a jingly way, "In Washington DC, there is diversity." We created a nice and decorative little board that had little flowers on the border and information on it about our organization. It looked wonderful. We did have fun making it, too. What I learned about diversity is it is the appreciation for the differences in humans around us. So I want to put these leadership traits in my life with the Youth Empowerment Council. I would love to help in my community by making decisions to do community service and help charities and do presentations for YEC. It would take leadership skills to help others, such as willingness to help. With helping with charities, it would be teamwork. And then and in presentations, knowledge and bravery. These are all very important concepts in life, and there are a whole bunch more. Thank you for letting me speak to you, council members and Madam Mayor, and I hope you have a very great evening.
I believe Vice Mayor Pacheco has some words to say.
So you're kind of getting me caught. I was going to say something at the end here, but so Tyler came to the youth town hall meeting last week, and this is the reason why I did the youth town hall meeting. And I posted on my Facebook page today, hashtag Casper Youth Movement. So the whole point of this is exactly what you're doing, Tyler, is that young people coming up here and addressing the council and then taking the initiative to get involved in their community, not only through the Youth Empowerment Council, but taking the initiative to be a part of their community. And so that empowerment that you feel right now when you came to the town hall meeting to say, we don't have all the answers, we're not going to change everything, but that you have an opportunity right now in seventh grade, right? Mm-hmm. In seventh grade, you have that within you to make that difference in your community. What I also love to hear is that section that you guys did, the session in diversity and understanding everybody and also teamwork and how to work together for a common cause. But more importantly, Tyler, what's more important is that you learn that we have to work together. Because we don't, and I said this at the town hall meeting, if we don't work together, nothing will get accomplished if we're yelling at each other. And so that's my point. And so what you're doing right now, this is exactly what the whole point of this, of having a Casper youth movement right now. So very proud of you, and it's been a pleasure and an honor to get to meet you. And I look forward to coming to visit you at the governor's mansion.
Thank you.
I think he gave me a run for mayor. We're going to have to give you an air fist bump.
Is he 25?
Well, I thought so when I scanned the crowd to do the pledge. He just is so mature and well-spoken and poised and brave. We're proud of you.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming. Yeah.
Thank you.
Good job, man.
Anyone else in the audience who wishes to speak to council? Good evening.
Good evening. Dale Zimmerly, 3035 Bel Air Drive. Thank you, Mr. Laird and Mr. Welsh, for speaking on CADA. I was going to talk about that tonight. And if their books won't open, don't give them no money. It's pretty simple. In fact, I also realize, I think it's on the board of directors, there's some citizen appointees from the council to be on that board. I'd volunteer to be one because I'd make them open their book, or I'd have to say something that I won't say here. But thank you very much, guys, for bringing that up. So often we hear about these things getting put on the back burner. You just put it to the side and don't talk about it anymore. And another year goes by, and they still get their $400,000. They've been given millions of dollars over the last 15 years, whatever it's been. And what have they done with it? What businesses have started? How many jobs are created? What have they done except spend money and with no return? And I think things like that need to change. Also, we talk about tightening our belts on our budgets. But every year, the city still spends money on a golf course that loses $1 million a year and an event center that costs hundreds of thousands of dollars a year out of the city budget. Stop doing it. If there's a tight budget, it's better to have water and sewer flowing than it is to have a golf course that loses money every year. These things need to change. It's our money, and we need to know what's going on with it, and not, to me, it's a waste when you give it to a losing business, from the ski resort to the event center to the golf course, all three of those. Stop spending money. If they need to survive, they need to make money on their own. That's about all I have to say on that. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Who else in the audience wishes to speak to council? Good evening.
Woody Giles, 290 East Magnolia in Casper. I wasn't going to speak, but I have to. I don't golf. I rarely go to the event center. I don't ski. But all of those things have made me, has put money in my pocket, so to speak. So it is not a waste of money. CADA is. I thoroughly agree that they shouldn't get another dime. I went to the HuffPost Listen to America thing a few days ago, and the good news is where the education thing is only down $500 million, so they're looking for some revenue. And the fact of the matter is, history has told us you cannot tax yourself out of a downturn. You have to try and decide what caused the downturn and do it different. There's a lot of places, I'm sure, that don't have coal mines and oil wells and that sort of thing and still have a reasonably vibrant economy. So I've been here a long time. I've been here for years. So most of you have heard me talk about what you could do to stimulate the economy and create jobs and lower business costs and that sort of thing, and it really hasn't amounted to anything. But now's the time you've got to start have to pay attention, because it's important now. So there's some economic laws, and in a basic form is that the human creature seeks to satisfy his desires, their desires, with the least exertion. They want the most for the least. It's an economic law that it's like gravity. It doesn't matter whether you like it or not. That's just the way it is. Another part of that law is that people have unlimited desires. It's also a truth. What that means is that means everybody working 24 hours a day cannot create enough stuff to satisfy all the desires. Now, that's obviously not going on, so that means we're doing something wrong as far as jobs and that sort of thing, and I've mentioned how you could look into it, see if my statements are correct and my facts are right, and you haven't really bothered to do that, and now you're in a situation that you are, but four golf courses and a Hogadon and skating rinks and indoor pools and all that sort of thing make Casper a better place to be. And it's not a waste of money. And so now you don't have enough money to pay the people that work at the dump. Well, there's a way to fix that. And I've explained it to you a time or two. Prove me wrong. So I know the city manager doesn't know what the hell I'm talking about, but ask any of these people, they'll explain it to you. So anyway, get rid of CADA, $400,000, okay? Any questions?
Councilman Huckabee, Councilwoman Huckabee.
I would like for you to sit down with our city manager and explain this to him, because I think that he's going to have a better understanding of it than maybe some of us up here, but when you presented it to us, it makes a lot of sense. And the fact that my land is worth more than Charlie's land is crazy to me.
And I don't know if I mentioned it, but the most, I've only looked at like 50 locations, enough to prove to me that something's going on. But you don't have the most expensive land.
Did Dallas beat me out?
No. A friend of mine who lives in Brookhurst has the most expensive land. I thought you'd find that interesting. It's $420,000 an acre. And it's also the site of a Superfund site. That's why it's so valuable. It's all the chemicals right under the ground. So any other questions?
Thank you.
I'd like to have a sit down with you sometime, Mr. City Manager. Okay. Woody Giles.
Who else would like to speak to the council? Good evening.
Madam Mayor and members of the council, esteemed City Manager. Keith Goodenough, 333 South Saucony. Years ago in my younger political life, I was a lobbyist at the legislature, and I lobbied for the Coalition Against Domestic Violence and Sexual Assault for about 18 months during the 93 and 94 legislative sessions, and we got a lot of good work done at that time. The stalking law was passed, and we passed four or five other laws that were designed to help victims of stalking. So I've been a lobbyist in my past. And I bring that up because the city is going to be fighting for funding when the legislative budget session comes up here in February. And if there's a $500 million shortfall in the school operations budget, that money's going to have to come from somewhere. So money's going to be tight, and I think the state operating budget is projected to be short as well. So the cities and towns and counties are going to be fighting with everybody else for the money. And if you go to the legislative website, you'll see a list of interim committee meetings. Many of those meetings are held in Casper. I believe this month there's been five or six meetings in Casper of different legislative committees. Every legislative committee has 13 legislators on it. So all these legislators are coming to town, and our prime opportunity for the city council to lobby and educate those legislators while they're here in town, because they're here for one or two nights, sometimes three nights. And I know you have a representative to WAM on the council. I'm not sure who it is now, but I think you're missing the bet if you don't make an effort to talk to all those legislators when they come to town for their various meetings. Because just sending the WAM representatives to the session and expecting to get the best result is not going to cut it. So I suggest, and I'm sharing my great idea with you, no charge, I suggest you have a team of two council people meet with legislators, go to coffee with them, take them to lunch if you have to, buy them breakfast, even dinner, go and educate them on what municipal funding is all about, because there's 500 issues at the legislature, and they're not going to understand all the ins and outs of municipal funding. So that is my suggestion to you, in the hopes that Casper will get a better deal when they pass their funding bill for cities, towns, and counties. And I wouldn't doubt that half the legislature is going to be at a meeting here in town before February. And because I'm a good citizen of Casper, I'm going to volunteer to train you to be a lobbyist. So you can just call upon me. We can do some role playing. We'll get you all fixed up. My suggestion would be the two women be the lobbyists, because male legislators tend to respond better to goddesses than they do to minions. So I would suggest the two women be trained to meet with these legislators and educate them as to what's going on. And the best lobbying teams at the legislature when I was there were two women. So that is my suggestion to you, because if you pay $60,000 to belong to WAM or somewhere in there, and you think that they're going to go and lobby and get the best deal out of the legislature, well, I will tell you that is not going to get you the best deal possible. And it makes no sense to ignore all of these legislators when they're right in your backyard, and you can educate them, get a certain amount of commitment from them to support cities and towns, because the budget could very easily be cut by 20%. Who knows what's going to happen? So I want you to think about that. And I realize lots of groups of elected officials have a tendency to fall prey to CDD. Citizen Defiance Disorder. So when somebody like me comes up with a suggestion, there's this tendency to think, well, if it was such a great idea, we would have thought of it on our own. But as a former lobbyist, I'm telling you that's how I lobbied. When I had a meeting in Sundance or wherever I was going, I'd find out who was in the legislature that was on the way, and I'd go to their ranch, and I'd sit down with them. I'd just work them outside of the legislative situation, and that is the way that you bring people along, because you can't just lay down the law and say, you got to do this, and that is not the way to go. So I hope on behalf of all the citizens of Casper that you will consider doing this, because I really think you've got a great opportunity to talk to all these legislators, and a lot of them haven't been there very long, they don't know a lot, so somebody's got to educate. Thank you.
Thank you. Us goddesses will get on that.
I am willing to train you.
I have a question of Mr. Goodenough. I made a comment to the council the other day that it was in my mind that maybe we should quit WAM. Now, I have a lot of reasons for saying that. I didn't explain to him at the time. How does that strike you?
I would be opposed to that with the proviso that they have to get better at what they do. I believe you need a presence there, and if Casper pulls out as one of the bigger municipalities in the state, then I think you're going to decrease their effectiveness. But I believe they could be much more effective than they are, and the easy way to gauge their effectiveness is to call and say, How many legislators have you met with face-to-face in the last month? And if they say none, then you know they're not doing their job. Every organization should meet with legislators on an ongoing basis, in my opinion.
I'm assuming we pay more to be in WAM than everybody other than Cheyenne, by far.
Madam Mayor, when I was on the council, I believe it was right at $60,000 a year. So I don't know what it's done since then, but I would suspect it's close to that. Thank you.
Anyone else in the audience who wishes to speak to council? Good evening.
Good evening. My name is Shannon Eli. I live at 2382 Sagewood Avenue. And Mayor and City Council members, I'd like to thank Councilman Johnson for his no vote. Not everybody can afford a cup of coffee, and during the downward times, everybody's raising prices to compensate for the money they're losing. So that may be a cup of coffee here, but by the end of the road, it's your grocery bill for the end of the month. So I want to thank him for his no vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Who else in the audience would like to come down? Okay. We'll go ahead and go around the table. We'll start with Councilman Hopkins.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. This week, a couple things were going on. We had a DCBA meeting on Monday morning. We had an OYD meeting this week. And we also had, this morning, we had the CADA report, the quarterly meet breakfast meeting that CADA has, where they report to the citizens of the community and CADA members on what they're going on. I understand there is some apparent animosity towards CADA, but I think there are some things you really have to ask yourself. CADA is literally our economic development arm. We give them somewhere to the tune of about $400,000 a year, and that is used exclusively for operations. It has nothing to do with the amount of money that they raise through grants and loans from the state of Wyoming. Nor does it have anything to do with the $2.1 million that they've invested in private funds to invest, and so far some of that has already been invested. Another thing I think you have to look at, if we took this function in-house, so to speak, for $400,000 you're supplying rent, which they'd have to have an office space to work in somewhere. We don't have a lot of office space in the city of Casper that we own. You're going to have to supply a staff of three or four. There is an executive director and a staff of three, each one taking a certain perspective on economic development. There's technology, medicine, and there's a third one. I don't remember what it is off the top of my head. But if we're to take this in-house, first of all, we lose in terms of actual ability to negotiate, confidentiality. When you're working with potential customers outside of town that want to move to town, it's really hard to put a dollar value on confidentiality. But if you make that a public property, everything they do has to become public. And that makes it very difficult to do any economic development. Kind of along the same lines, I think this year we did have a pretty conservative budget. And right now, one of the things we did, we put a conservative estimate in there for what we were going to get from 1 cent tax. Currently, we are, for the month, 14.5% ahead. That turns into $183,000, almost $184,000 ahead for the last month that was reported to us. For the year to date, we're almost $680,000 ahead for the year. Now, that's with 4 months behind us, 4 months under the belt. That turns into about $2 million a year, which covers a big majority of the money that we took out of our savings to balance the budget last year. So I just wanted to say that to clarify kind of what's going on. We are not destitute. We made a conservative budget, and we're better than on target for what we estimated on sales tax. Thank you.
Councilman Walsh.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'll be brief. Consideration of Councilwoman Huckabam. Good to see you here. Water Board, pretty status quo. There's a couple big projects, a backflow system that's a little bit behind projected estimates on completion, and the weather hasn't been helping that. And water production last month, was it, is down because of the snowstorms that came in. All in all, everything's looking good. So is reduction in chemicals in for treating the water, just because of our water's in pretty good shape. So nothing alarming to bring up there. Madam Mayor, thank you so much for bringing young Tyler in here. Where'd that young man go? I kind of feel like doing the same thing. Are you his mother?
I am.
You should be very proud. That is a fantastic young man. What a presence. And Jesse, thank you for the prescription plan idea. Wouldn't have happened if you wouldn't have brought it to our attention. That's all, Madam Mayor.
Okay, thank you. Councilman Powell.
Thank you, Your Honor. I attended the Huffington Post discussion Friday evening, and it was very impressive to listen to Senator, Senator Landon, and Representative from Cheyenne, Chris Rothfuss, talk about the very difficult challenges that the state legislature will be facing in the upcoming session with the budgetary problems that they're looking at. But also very impressive to hear from the staff person from the Department of Education that came forward to talk a little bit about things they've been doing to try to provide assistance to districts. And they corrected some misinformation that has been spread about the quality of our education in Casper, which is very good. And we are making serious progress in the quality as measured by standardized testing. I also attended the Leisure Board meeting, and with all due respect, Mr. Zimmerly, our golf course is in the black. So, and people are extremely happy with the condition of the course. Rounds are down for the same reason a lot of things are down. It's something that people can cut out of their budget. But it's going very well, and people that are using our course are very happy with it. Since people have made some very negative remarks about CADA, I am okay with us requiring additional transparency. I remind everyone we did have CADA come to the council meeting about, 4 months ago, I think it was, maybe 5 months ago. And there was some disappointment in their presentation. And so we can certainly require some additional information. But really, $400,000 to run an office with three full-time staff person, I don't know what the going rate would be for that, but that doesn't seem out of line for me. But people say, well, what's CADA doing? Well, I should have reported on this a month ago, but I attended a meeting of the Forward Casper group that CADA sponsors and puts together. And most people, I was not aware of the fact that there are consultants that basically work with businesses all over the country to help them find a suitable location. And the CADA invited four of these consultants to Casper.
Once to come, yeah.
And gave them a full tour of our city and all of the things that we have, including our golf course, including our revitalized downtown, et cetera. And these people were just floored by what they saw. Now, we don't know what that's going to, it's very hard to translate that into numbers. But any reasonable person would have to think it increases the likelihood that something significant would come our way as these consultants are working with these various businesses around the country. And there are confidentiality issues. If I own a company and I'm looking for a place to relocate, I really don't want that to be in the front page of my home paper, that I came to Casper to talk to them about relocating my business to Casper. I don't want that. And if I know Casper's going to operate that way, I'm not even going to look at it. So they have to have some privacy in working with these companies. Now, I understand you want additional transparency, and I think we should have them come back and find out what their reasons are and require some additional information about this expenditure of that money. But this is a highly competitive business, economic development. And if you take your team off the field, well, you just forfeited. And forfeit is a bad strategy in a very competitive game. And so if we have another strategy, fine. I'm all ears. But we don't want to forfeit the only strategy we have. so or the only team that we have. So let's stay relaxed about it and give them a chance to answer these questions. Thank you.
Councilman Walsh, did you want to say anything to our young future mayor now that he's back in the room?
I would love to. I was complimenting on you on your presentation and the outstanding demeanor that you've got. You command an audience, and you are going to go far, young man. I appreciate you coming up, and we welcome you anytime.
Thank you. Councilwoman Huckabee.
I wonder where I'd be today if I were doing what you're doing at your age, because I certainly wasn't doing that. So congratulations on all that you've accomplished, and it's very refreshing to see someone of your age to be so engaged and involved in the community, so keep that up. Speaking of things on the back burner, I again would like to see our strategic goals that we put into place with measurable outcomes come to fruition months and months later. I also went to the HuffPost. I didn't go to the educational part because it was at night, and as many of you know, I just had a very major surgery, and nighttime things don't mix with medications. So I did go to the HuffPost interview that they were doing at the David Street Station during the day to represent the demographic that I represent, and that was, I was very happy to see that they stopped here on their tour across the nation. I also attended the State of the Community event last week. I was on heavy medication, so that's kind of a blur. I want to thank Dallas for taking such good care of me during my surgery, and Kaneen. I appreciate food and chocolate. And I got a nice surprise get well from Mr. Ed Murray. He's a nice guy. Keith, I do hope that while you recognize that Kaneen and I are goddesses, we both work full-time and do this, so I do hope in all your spare time you'll join us. And as far as CADA goes, as Bob pointed out, we fund operations. Casper Housing Authority and the Downtown Development Authority are also our arms in those respective areas of the city, and we don't fund their operations. However, when we do give them money, we require funding and detailed accounting of how that money is spent. So I'm not quite sure why we would have an agreement with a power company to specifically fund one arm of our city as opposed to not others, especially when one of those is supporting our most vulnerable populations. And that's it.
Thank you. Councilman Laird.
Well, I hope you're feeling better, Amanda. It sounds like you are. You'll get to 100% soon. Young man, you were great, really. Your mom's been smiling the whole time, and she certainly has a right to do that. And keep up the good work. It'll pay off someday. It really will. I listen to Charlie and Bob more than I used to. Probably should have listened to them sooner.
We had nowhere to go but up.
I know you did. And I appreciate, gentlemen, what you're saying about the respective boards you're on. And I appreciate that. I, though, believe that the public should know where we spend the money. Now, and I've heard both from CADA and the Downtown Development Authority this argument of keeping things quiet and secret because it's economic development and all of that. there are some thinkers out there that believe when that gets said, that is a red herring. And what that means, if you haven't heard about red herring, it means that it's not really real in a sense. They want you to be looking at something else. And the battle that we've had with CADA has exasperated our mayor from time to time. I remember when they did come and just refused to answer these questions about where they spend this money. I truly, as a new council member then, I was a little concerned. I just couldn't believe that they were handling it that way, especially from the people standing here who could go, no, we're not going to give you $400,000 anymore. And I think if we take the $400,000 away and we ask the city attorney to get on the ball and defuse that joint powers board, probably people will show up with a little more transparency. Now, I know getting on these boards is something I've also addressed, Mr. Mayor, before, or Mr. Manager, before you came on board, and because I go to some of these meetings, and what you do when I go, I start liking the people, and I start understanding the people, and I talk to them generally about what's happening on their boards. But I've always thought, for me, it's a conflict of interest, because there I am now, having been on boards with people, and then something comes up where really I don't want to vote for them, but yet I have this underlying feeling that I should, because I'm on their board and I want to be a good board member there. And I've said, really, if we can do it lawfully, I don't think we ought to serve on boards, because I think it's a conflict of interest. I think it tends to have you leaning more in a biased manner toward the board you're on, rather than being able to look at it in a totally unbiased fashion. That's just my own opinion. I don't expect anybody to adopt my opinion, but I think that we have big matters to deal with on this council. Who was the gentleman that said you can't tax your way out of a recession? And that's a big economic principle. That's true. Because it's like my old McDonald's analogy, where when things got bad, they made a bigger, better burger, and they got all the business. The people that shrunk the burgers no longer exist anymore. So that's a huge metaphor that may take hold at some point. So everything that's being said here by my fellow council members, I'm going, gosh, there's a truth in that. There's a truth in what Sean says. You start taxing $1.50 to some people and a few $1.50s, and they're in trouble. So it's an interesting balance being on this council to see how we should be directing ourselves. And one of the directions that I believe for me works, and that is to keep trying to get this budget balanced. And certain things have to be done that are uncomfortable, but I've lived through these ups and downs of Wyoming's economy, and there's times when you splurge money and there's times when you cinch your belt and you don't spend money. And we're in a belt-cinching time. And so it's just balancing all of these issues with, you know, the people from Hogadon, and I can see where that's probably a viable situation for them up there. But I think giving, and I guess we're kind of picking on Kata, but maybe they deserve to be picked on. And $400,000 is a lot of money. That would go a long way to balancing your budget. And they're making all this money and they're doing all these things, and they don't want to tell us how much they pay their salaries and all of this. I don't want to give them any more money. I want them to stand up like a good citizen. You know, I get paid $600 a month basically to be a city councilman. And then when you take taxes out of that, it's less. And so I didn't come here for the money. But I'm willing to tell people what I do with the money. All they got to do is ask me, and I'll tell them. And I'll tell them what we do with our money down here if they ask me. Because I don't like anything to be secret. I know we had a lawsuit that's just been resolved, and the lady is here that brought the lawsuit, and in my opinion, she won the lawsuit, and our lawyer filed the response. And I hope that never happens again, because I think we should tell the people what we do. If we make a decision or we don't make a decision, the people are entitled to know. They're entitled to know what we do with the money, and truly they're entitled to know what we do behind closed doors to the extent the law allows us to do that. And then we have no problems. Cato wouldn't have one problem with me if they'd have come in, Mayor, when you set that meeting up and said, here's how much I make and here's how much we make and you guys are paying the salaries. They wouldn't have had a problem with me. but it's sticking in my craw. And somehow, I hope I get enough votes to take their money away from them. And Mr. Vice Mayor, these things that you're doing with children are fantastic. So never give that up. I mean that. I don't think that the word confidentiality should be used by this council, other than what we're legally required to do. I think our citizens are entitled to know what we do and why we do it. The Huffington Post is an interesting deal. I know Amanda gave a, the green-haired councilwoman gave her a deal, and I got to go down there and they interviewed me. It was about the country and what have you, and I don't know whether they're going to play those. I see Sloan back here with K2. He says he thinks they're going to play those videos at some point in time. I can almost be as famous as Jesse because he made the New York Times, you know. Look at how good he looks in that black suit, ladies and gentlemen. I mean, I told him, if I look that good in a black suit, and see, I've wore one, I don't look nearly as good as he does, but I'm going to keep working on it. And then our council members that stand up for the little guy specifically, I really appreciate that because I understand where you're going with that $1.50 cup of coffee. And I don't know if you know it, Sean is a jailer for the Natrona County Sheriff's Department, and he sees people going in and out of there, in and out of that jail, that it's just sad. It's a sad thing what's happening. We have one person that goes in and out of the jail on drinking, and he owes the city $50,000 in fines, and somehow we can't figure out a way to quit fining him because he has no money. It's sad that our city's doing this to some of our lesser people that are, by lesser I mean that are not blessed with an income and that are more than likely, none of them want to be where they are. Somehow we as a city council and our city manager need to address hardships that perhaps we unconsciously or unknowingly put on our citizens. And I appreciate, Mr. Manager, the email you sent me, because the lady said she went to the hospital, had surgery, and she had no way to get home. And she said the CATSI bus wouldn't pick her up, but I'm going to share her email with you because she said there are a lot of poor people that can't go to the hospital and make it home because they don't have a ride. I heard that. It was something that never occurred to me that was happening in the city, especially because we have transportation. And so, Amanda, you need to straighten that out.
I think she's saying you better wrap it up before she throat punches me for letting you talk so long.
Okay, and that she's right. I'm sorry, Amanda. Thank you. I'm finished till the next meeting.
Councilman Johnson.
I don't have any animosity toward CADA. I understand what they do and the importance of CADA. But I do believe that in this type of a money situation that we're in, that nobody should be taken off the microscope to be looked at. And I also agree that they need to be held to the same standard that any other taxpayer-funded organization is held to as far as reporting to the city. With respect to the nay vote on the franchise agreement, I don't have any animosity towards Rocky Mountain Power either, and I do think they do a good job. But my concern was with the 7% franchise fee. We continue to raise fees and continue to bit by bit add little taxes here and there or pseudo taxes here and there, and eventually it becomes a bigger than $1.50. So that's the reason I voted no on it. And I think that's about all I have.
Councilman Morgan.
Thank you, Mayor. And Mr. Kessel, outstanding work today. It was great seeing you up here at the podium. And I had received an alert when you were up there that this meeting is actually on Facebook Live, which I didn't know that was taking place for this meeting. So not only did he talk to the group here and the group live on channel 192, but also the rest of the World Wide Web. So congratulations on conducting yourself in a professional manner.
Okay, you guys have to show us where you see that so we can look too. Okay, teach me on my phone later. Sorry, keep going.
City of Casper's Facebook page. Thank you, Councilman Pell, for addressing the golf course. Yes, they do make, I think, $150,000 a year. They are making money. The event center, it's closer to $1 million loss year over year, and that's why we moved towards privatizing the management of the event center, and I think they're positive results. I can't wait to actually see one whole calendar year of what they've done to the place. I mean, just going up there and seeing all the sponsorships, it's incredible. It's changed a lot and for the better. Hogadon, we're working on that. Hopefully the lodge will get there. We'll see what happens. It's certainly going to attract people for the right reasons. Mr. Goodenough, thank you for bringing up the fact that there are people from around the state here for appropriations meetings or whatever's taking place. I appreciate that. I was very active during this last session. Also went to a few meetings with Councilman Powell, and it was very enlightening what takes place among a small group of people, and it hinges on each one of their votes on whether or not it actually goes to the floor. So they're very important meetings. Certainly any state representative at that point can bring forward something that failed in those meetings and address it on the floor, but that typically doesn't get passed. So it is important to be heavily involved. I am heavily involved, but as myself, not as a councilman. I don't throw my title out there or where I'm coming from. It's just me, average citizen, and this is why I feel strongly about it. And in some of those cases, it actually conflicts with this group too on what we're proposing towards WAM and also what WAM is proposing. And we've seen that during a recent WAM convention that took place in Gillette. Councilman Laird, thank you for all your compliments. And you know, what can we do for some of those people that owe so much money towards the city of Casper? It's definitely worth looking into. Today we just received, or we're going to have that agreement where we're receiving $20,000 from YDOT, for example, and I think that would be great to see that go towards maybe overtime for the police to monitor people picking up trash along our I-25 corridor as opposed to municipal workers that we have. Every taxpayer would probably love to see them make $15 a day and pick up trash. If that's legal, I'm not sure, but we could certainly use that money for a police officer for those that are convicted, not for those that are in the jailhouse. Apart from that, why I voted no for Councilman Johnson's, or I guess why I supported Councilman Johnson's 5% is we're basically gaining that 2%. And then we can certainly have those talks with CADA to understand, do they need that 1%? Where are they at? What are they doing with it? And I think that's the important thing. That's why I was hoping that we would get towards that second meeting and kind of understand more what they can offer us and why it's worth it. I don't think we should continue to add more fees, especially being the highest in probably the state, to every citizen in Casper. In 2015, we saw a downturn, and council ultimately went on to spend probably the most ever in the history of Casper for fiscal year 16. So it's easy to say, you know, we've cut so much out of our budget, but at the same time, we're comparing it to a record year. And still, if you look at those revenue numbers for sales tax is still far lower than what it was for our fiscal 16 budget and FY15. And I can go on and on about that. So I think it's important that we remain vigilant on our budget. We look at everything. I'm glad that there are council members here bringing forth those questions and concerns, and I'm glad that we're also addressing them and tackling them with our city manager. And that's all I have. Thank you.
Mr. Vice Mayor.
Yeah, I'll be brief. But last week held the first youth town hall meeting, which was held at Metro, had about 25 or 30 students that came to them, including Tyler, who came with about the most enthusiastic smile I've ever seen on a young person, which is great. I just wanted to say Katie did a really nice job in their article. Thank you for being there and covering that. I appreciate it. The reason I did it and the reason I am continuing to do these other meetings and brainstorming sessions with youth in the community is that it's important that our generation that's coming up knows that there's a better way to do government. I always believe that there's a better way. And at the risk of sounding a bit dramatic, I told the students that the opportunity and the hope lie in you guys. And I truly believe that and always believe that in the time I've worked with youth. And so town hall meetings for young people aren't just a publicity stunt or a opportunity for us to just to get together and pat them on their heads and say nice job and go along your way and we'll thanks for talking, we'll talk again. But with partnership with the Youth Empowerment Council, we're hoping to also work together to make positive change in the community. And young people certainly express their opinions, and I'll be bringing that later to the council, their opinions, their thoughts, what they want in this community. And I told them that within a youth movement like this in Casper, that they can have great change, positive change. And they are our hope, and we are under their microscope. They see us. They know what we do. They judge the people in politics. They see the nastiness of it and want better. And they certainly challenge me to be better. So young people like Tyler, you inspire me to continue to be in public service for that very reason. This stuff's important, but what's more important is how we leave a legacy for our community and a legacy for young people. That's before we have to understand that that what we do as a community should really bear what we do with the young people. And so, Tyler, I hope you're going to be a leader in that and be a part of that. And so we'll be doing more. We're looking at doing one in January. We'll be having another one, but also be partnering with the Youth Empowerment Council as we work on a project together to tackle any of the issues in Casper that they think that we need to do. And they'll be presenting those and bringing that to council and challenging us to do better. So good job, Tyler. I'm proud of you, buddy. All right.
Well, it sounds like the vice mayor and I have the wide range of ages down pretty well. Vice mayor's been taking care of youth, and I apologize for missing last week, but I had a great time teaching seniors and caregivers about dementia and how to deal with it and respond to it, and it was a good time. So thank you all for coming tonight. The next meetings of the City Council will be a work session to be held at 4:30 p.m. Tuesday, October 24th, 2017 in the Council's meeting room, and a regular Council meeting to be held at 6 p.m. November 7th, 2017 in the Council chambers. The Chair would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So move.
Second.
Moved by Councilman Johnson, seconded by Councilman Morgan. Please cast your vote. It's past my bedtime. Please record the vote.
Voting aye, motion passes.
Thank you. We are adjourned.